Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie, thank you so much for taking the time to speak to us here on the BBC's 100 Women season.
Thank you.
We're just going to start off talking about how a lot of our audience might have come across you, and especially with the We Should All Be Feminists TED Talk from 10 years ago almost.
Wow.
Yeah, exactly. How do you reflect on those days now? And how would you say your thoughts have perhaps changed since 2012?
It's interesting. I haven't actually realized it's been that long. I mean, I think my view of feminism is still really the same, which is that I think feminism is fundamentally a justice movement. And I realize, of course, that that word feminist has so many negative connotations. And my giving the talk was a way of trying to take it back to its basic fundamental meaning, which is that we should all really want equality. We should all really want justice. I've never quite understood why there's so much hostility to conversations around feminism. This idea that women just want to be full and equal human beings, or they want to be considered, because they are, obviously. Women are full and equal human beings, but the world refuses to acknowledge that. And so when I gave that talk, I think I also wanted to talk about feminism in a way that's accessible to people, right? In a way that isn't about theory, or a way that isn't even necessarily political, but really about people's lives.
One of the important things you've talked about is how anger can be a major force when it comes to responding to social constructs around gender. How do you think women today can use anger as a force, a positive force?
In so many parts of the world, women are socialized to deny their anger, to be afraid of being seen as angry. And I think in the West in particular, women in general are really not permitted anger. I mean, to be considered an angry woman has so many negative connotations. And I think if you're a black woman, it's disastrous because there's already a stereotype of the angry black woman. And I think because women are aware of that, then there's a tendency to downplay their anger. I think women really need to start owning their anger because the anger is justified. I think most people in the world today who care about justice should be angry because there's so much that isn't right. And I think anger can be a propelling force. Sometimes because we are angry, we're propelled to act. I don't know if I would have spoken about how I think we should all be feminists if I hadn't been angry. The goal of feminism is to make itself redundant. We want to get to a world where we no longer need feminism, which means that it has to be a democratic idea. And when I talk to people, I just say to them, look around the world, look at your own experience. I grew up really with wonderful parents in a family that was very progressive. My parents were friends and were equals. But despite that, it was still very obvious to me as a child that the world just does not give women the same dignities that it gives men. And this was seen as just normal. And to question it, you were made to feel strange for questioning it. I then later heard stories of my great-grandmother, my father's grandmother, who was considered a troublemaker in my hometown. And the reason she was considered a troublemaker is because her husband had died young and his brothers wanted to take away her property and she resisted. She said, I have a son, I need to raise my son, you cannot take away my things. And because she resisted, she was considered a troublemaker. And so I think troublemaker is a wonderful label for a woman. As long as it's good trouble. So really what I would say to people is, think about your lives. Think about, have you been in situations where women are treated differently for the same behavior? And also I think it's important to say that we're not saying that men and women are the same. They're not. But that's the whole point. If men and women were the same, we would not have sexism. The reason we have sexism is that based on the differences between men and women, people have then sort of given negative value to all of the attributes that women have. So it's not that men and women are the same, it's that men and women are different, obviously, but that they're equally human.
And you've chosen to use your voice and your platform as a world-renowned writer to talk about these issues. How does it make you feel that you have become a cultural icon around the world? And what do you feel are the responsibilities that come with that?
I don't actually always remember that. I mean, I sort of don't wake up and think I'm a cultural icon. I don't even know what that is. I think because of literature, I then had this platform where people want me to come speak somewhere. And so really, I made the choice to talk about the things I care about. But those are not really the things that are at the center of my heart. Right? The things that are at the center of my heart are writing and reading and dreaming. But if I'm able to make a difference using that platform, then I want to do it. Do I feel a sense of responsibility? I think so. But it's a responsibility that I don't want somebody else to define for me. And I remember years ago telling somebody in my hometown who said to me, "You're a role model, you have to be very careful." And I said, you know, on the one hand, I'm honored that you would think I'm a role model. But on the other hand, there's a part of me that resists that because often people use that to then want to tell you how to be. And this person was saying it in the context of my writing. So he said, "You're a role model, so you cannot write about sex." I think the idea was that Africans don't have sex, I guess. And I thought, no. So responsibility is something I define for myself. But above all else, I want to say what I think. And I've just never believed in performing being truly myself is important to me. Authenticity is important to me. Obviously, there are consequences to refusing to perform as a person living as a public person in the world. And I'm willing to take on those consequences.
Part of grief's tyranny is that it robs you of remembering the things that matter. His pride in me mattered more than anyone else's.
Speaking about your most recent piece of work, your latest book, Notes on Grief, which looks at the grief you've experienced since the passing of your father, James, and also, you know, the passing of your mother, Grace, as well. You talk about still processing the grief, not knowing what you're learning, what you're understanding. So I just wanted to ask you, how are you doing right now? How is this process going for you?
I don't know. Like good days and bad days. And the days of just utter disbelief. I just really cannot believe what happened to us. You know,
He felt a bit unwell, had been sleeping poorly, but we were not to worry. On 8 June, Oke went to Aba to see him and said he looked tired. On 9 June, I kept our chat brief so that he could rest. He laughed quietly when I did my playful imitation of a relative. "Kachifo," he said, "good night," his last words to me. On 10 June, he was gone. My brother Chooks called to tell me, and I came undone.
It's funny because actually earlier today, I just felt very light. And I don't mean that in a good way. I felt like I could very easily be blown away. I was very close to my parents. My parents, I wouldn't be who I am without them. They were remarkable people. Even saying the past tense feels surreal even now. So I don't know. I do know that I'm a changed person. I'm changed. I cannot be the person I was before June of 2020 because something catastrophic has happened in my life. And I just look at things really differently now. There's a kind of patience I no longer have for rubbish, for example. I'm so much more aware of mortality. I'm thinking about what do I want my life to be? Like, who do I really want to be? And I don't know how much longer I have, because what happens when you're grieving is that suddenly you're so aware of mortality. Death is so close. It's changed me. It's also made me very angry. There's just so much rage.
In your writing, you talked about how you shied away from public grieving. But since then, in recent weeks, you've been generous enough to share this grief with us so publicly. Can you tell us why you've chosen to do that now, why you've chosen to have such a public conversation about your grief?
Because I actually find it ever so slightly comforting. And also because my siblings and I are very close, but we're all just really burdened with our suffering. And we lean on each other, but there are times when I want to reach out to someone who's not family because there's a sense in which it's almost safer. It's more consequence-free. You're not making it more difficult for someone that you love. And also because I kind of hope to help someone else. I mean, this grieving is such a strange thing. And death itself is so final and so fundamentally unknowable that it feels like trying to make your way through this very dark, deep hole. And there's that desire to not feel alone. And so I found it a bit comforting. I've also found it comforting to hear about the stories of other people who are grieving. And it's just that feeling of not wanting to be utterly alone, just thinking, right, this thing is horrible, but apparently it's a thing that's universal. So people all over the world are also going through this horrible thing. And it makes it feel just ever so slightly comforting.
One of the other issues that you've been very passionate about recently is speaking about cancel culture and the toxicity on social media. And in one of your latest essays, It Is Obscene, which you released in June or published in June, you talked about, you know, the wider issue of cancel culture. Why do you consider the public space of social media to be obscene, as you wrote in the essay?
I think what I consider obscene is not so much the public space of social media as it is how it has been used by certain people. There's something about using a screen that just makes you forget the humanity that's present. But most of all, that there's just good faith is dead. So those conversations are not in good faith. There's something very performative about it. People go on social media and put up things, and I think people say things they don't really believe. People are too quick. I mean, we now live in a world where there's just so much quickness to think the worst of someone and to put the worst possible spin on what somebody has said. The assumption, for example, is if you use the wrong language, you're morally bad. It's not that you've made a mistake, it's that you're morally bad. And these moral judgments then stick. And the next thing is that person needs to lose their job, that person needs to be, you know, fired from everything. And I cannot help but think, where is this going to end? You know, there are young people who are terrified of tweeting things, who read and reread their tweets before they send them out because they're worried somebody will come after them. And I don't participate, obviously, but being a public figure in general, I just don't mean myself, means that you're a target. And there's a sense in which I acknowledge and even accept that to an extent. But when it becomes, just really vile, then it's just not acceptable. You know, it's not okay. And I think a lot more of us should say it's not okay.
Has it had a personal impact on you when you see these comments?
I think part of the reason that I'm still sane is that I don't look at comments. However, of course, if there's something going on, I invariably hear that there's something going on. But I think the one thing that really tipped me over, and in some ways even made me write that essay, was having my nephew call me and tell me that there were people on social media saying that my parents had died and that it was good for me and it was punishment because I had refused to say trans women are women. I just found it so inhumane, you know, just so inhumane. And I think, you know, if you can trivialize something so serious as the death of a person's parents because a person refuses to participate in language orthodoxy, not because a person wants to deprive anybody of their rights, then something is really wrong.
Do you think then more your perception is about the tone, the language, the behavior that comes from cancel culture, and not necessarily people choosing to make economic decisions to stop supporting somebody because they disagree with their actions or their politics?
Oh, disagreeing and not supporting a person because you disagree with them is absolutely the right of everyone. I've often said that people who don't like my position should not buy my books, you know, because I'm actually not even writing for them. Right, but there's a difference between that and, for example, a person says something and suddenly you want them fired from their jobs. I mean, there's a sense in which we need to have a sense of proportion of punishment to crime. Right? You cannot, because someone has said, and often, I mean, for me, what bothers me the most, that it's often people who are naturally supposed to be on the same side. I mean, that's the thing that I find really troubling. And so there's no room for learning, growing. You know, somebody said one thing and suddenly everything that person stands for becomes irrelevant. And I don't really like the expression cancel culture because, again, it's become so politicized. Right? People have taken it to mean all kinds of things. I, for example, am a believer in, you know, if I read a book that someone has written that I find, for example, racist, I'm not going to buy the person's book the next time, right? Because I'm going to think, not what I want to do. But I don't know that I'm then going to sort of wage a campaign saying they should never speak anywhere, they should never. I'd rather use my energy on things that, I don't know, make more sense to me.
And obviously this whole conversation around you being cancelled, I'm sure there are probably a lot of opportunities or moments where people have talked about you being cancelled in the past. But obviously a lot of this came from your comments in 2017. From an interview where you talked about your feelings that trans women are trans women. You know, it's several years on. Does this still reflect your views today?
Yes.
Just explain that a bit more.
That I don't know that there's, I mean, I've never understood. And so even being asked this question, why am I being asked this question? In other words, what is it about trans women and trans women that is offensive?
There is a sense that by talking about trans women being trans women, they're being excluded from womanhood and being othered.
But in what way? I mean, there's a major logical fallacy to this. Because on the one hand, we say that we want to be inclusive. And the premise of inclusivity is that there are differences between us. Why then are we so unwilling to acknowledge those differences? In some ways, it seems to me like saying I'm colorblind, you know, and everyone is gray. I mean, you know, there's something about this impulse on the left to wish away difference because difference is the basis of oppression that I find actually quite patronizing to minority groups. You know, I'm of course, you know, deeply, and I have always been, in fact, deeply supportive of difference in general. And so when it comes to transgender people, I am, for example, deeply supportive of gender-affirming care. So if there are countries in which trans people want to transition and are being deprived of their health care, I think that's immoral, right? I think that trans people should be, you know, should never be sort of removed from anything, any civil thing, because they are trans people. But to then say that trans women and women have the same experiences just doesn't make sense. Because I think in some ways as well, it's denying the transness of trans people, and that's also wrong, right? But you know what? Fundamentally, this is about language orthodoxy. And that's really what my problem is. We now live in a world where you're supposed to say things in a particular way. And if you refuse to say that, it's just massive, massive, you know, sort of backlash. And, you know, and I just refuse to, I just, you know, I'm done. So I'm going to use the language I want to use. If I think that the language orthodoxy has a problem, I will not participate in it. But I don't think that it means that people should then accept that refusing to participate in this language orthodoxy means somehow that, as I have been told, I want people dead. I mean, the whole thing is absurd, right? And you cannot look at my history and my political positions and somehow credibly say that I want trans people dead. It's nonsense, right? I am completely in support of trans rights, but I'm just not going to participate in certain language orthodoxy that I think really masks the reality of different peoples. And we need to understand that it is in fact possible for things to coexist. Right. Sometimes one feels that that sort of the fashionable feminism of the day is one in which you're supposed to power up these orthodoxies. But somehow we're forgetting that there is a raging epidemic of violence against women everywhere in the world. It's an epidemic. And it just seems to me that it's almost become unfashionable to talk about those things. You know, it's an American invention. There are orthodoxies that we're supposed to parrot, and that makes us morally virtuous. But we're not even actually thinking about real things. And so I want to go back to this question because trans women have different needs. So let's talk about healthcare, right? The needs of trans women in terms of healthcare are very different from the needs of women born female. How do we then deal with that and the challenges that they have? Because there's still many countries that will deny trans people gender-affirming care. How do we deal with that if we're going to pretend that there are no differences? It just seems to me really a kind of, it's disingenuous.
You know, the world has changed dramatically over the past 2 years. Is there any particular advice you have at the moment in terms of how we raise women, or we raise feminists for mothers and fathers who are watching, in particular from your experience of now raising a daughter?
It's not just how we raise girls, it's also how we raise boys. I think there needs to be more gentleness infused in raising boys, because that way they can hopefully grew up to be men who are a bit more emotionally secure. And then with the way we raise girls, obviously gentleness is there already, but then maybe we need to infuse a little more a sense of resilience, a sense of strength, a sense of not apologizing for being who they are. And also to teach girls that they do not need the approval of everyone. You know, we live in a world where so many girls just have been raised to think that if one person doesn't like you, that's the end of the world. I just think it's a terrible thing to teach girls. And so what I would say to young girls, is, especially teenagers, if someone says they don't like you, it's important for you to say to them that you also have the ability to like and dislike, right? I mean, it's important for girls to think of themselves as subjects. You're just not an object that someone's saying, oh, I like you, I don't like you, change your behavior for me. No, you know, you sit tall and you tell them, well, actually, I kind of don't like you too. And there's going to be someone who will like you in the world, you know?
Thank you so much. I really appreciate time, and thank you for your generosity and being so open and so warm and talking to us about all these issues.
Thank you.